Hello and welcome to another episode of Hair Talk. My name is Dr. Joshua Chong, and today we'll be going to address some hair transplant myths. The first myth is that younger patients do not need a hair transplant procedure. This is a myth because it doesn't clearly describe the age range of what is considered young. So I would consider 28 quite young, but we still operate on patients who are 28 years old and above. There are also special considerations such as patients who do not actually have androgenetic hair loss that will advance with time, or just want to lower the hairline, such as in female hairline lowering procedures, which can be done at a slightly younger age if we feel like the genetic history does not predispose them to future hair loss. Myth number two, only men need a hair transplant procedure. Now, this is a myth. Not only men, but ladies as well can benefit from hair transplant procedures. Now, if you have a strong donor area and you are experiencing androgenetic hair loss or androgenetic balding, you will be able to use that donor hairs to restore some area of your hair on your scalp. But what makes you a suitable candidate is not your gender. There will be other factors being considered, such as medications you're on, the age of the patient, what kind of expectations we're expecting out of this procedure, and the overall impact of how much a hair transplant will do for you. For example, some patients will benefit more from medications perhaps than a hair transplant, and we advise them accordingly. Myth number three, you should not wash your hair after a hair transplant procedure as it will damage the grafts. Now, this is not entirely a myth. There will be some practices in other parts of the world, especially in places with more northern latitudes or southern latitudes, that discourage the washing of hair immediately after a hair transplant procedure in the winter. That's because you do not produce as much sebum when the temperature is not so hot. But in the tropics in Singapore, we encourage all our patients to come in the day after a procedure to get the bandage removed and to get a hair wash done by us, following which we will teach our patients how to do the hair wash for the following 7 days. And it's important to keep your scalp clean for the next 7 days because there will be areas that have been exposed, the skin has been breached and are prone to infection. So not entirely a myth, but our practice, we encourage washing. Myth number four, you don't need medication to help hair growth after a hair transplant. Now, the transplanted grafts are there to stay. They are permanent hairs by definition, and if it's selected from a suitable donor area, we're talking about 20 to 30 years of good hair growth, and they will grow as well as your donor hairs. But what is not permanent is the areas of hairs that were not transplanted into. We call them native hairs, and if you are facing androgenetic alopecia or if your age is more advanced, these hairs tend to go slightly thinner. We call that miniaturization. And sometimes medication is useful to slow down that process or actually reverse that process in some areas. For example, in the vertex. Next myth, it is okay to use someone else's hair or hair follicle for your hair transplant. This is a myth. They've tried it in identical twins. That has not been successful. You cannot use somebody else's hair for your own hair transplant. However, you can use donor hairs from other parts of your own body. For example, chest hair if you've got a sufficient amount, back hair, beard hair from under the chin can all be used for a hair transplant onto the scalp. Myth number six, hair transplant damages the neurological parts of your body. This is not entirely a myth, but possible side effects from a procedure. Now, when we use local anesthetic in a hair transplant, there are sometimes patients who experience a prolonged anesthesia, numbness that stays around for a few weeks sometimes, not having full sensation of the scalp sometimes for a month. And in cases of FUT or linear strip excision procedures, if it's not done carefully enough, you may be transecting or damaging the nerves, the occipital nerves that run up and supply sensation to the back of the scalp, causing numbness up to the vertex area. So I guess that was what this myth was alluding to. It's a possible side effect. Myth number 7, my hair or parting line will not look natural after doing a hair transplant. Now this is not a myth, but this is an example of a badly done hair transplant. I've had patients come to me after their hair transplant who have had very unnatural looking hairlines, parting lines or crowns, and they could, due to direction being wrong, or the density being too low, or an inappropriate follicular unit graft being chosen for that particular site. An example of would be planting triple grafts into the frontal hairline. That would be a very unnatural appearance. Next myth, transplanted hair will last forever. There have been cases where people have been buried and their hair is still alive and survives for a while. But transplanted hairs are not meant to last you forever. It is likely that they will last you more than a decade, probably even 2 decades, but all hair follicles will encounter some kind of shrinking over time, and the resultant hair that is produced from them will get thinner with time. Next myth, I'll only need one session of a hair transplant for a head full of hair. Now, this is not entirely true. This is a myth. Some people will need staging of 2 procedures or 3 procedures to achieve dense and full coverage, depending on your expectations. There will be some people who will benefit just from one session of a hair transplant, but we know that androgenetic baldness progresses with time, and it's likely that in a further 10 years, even with maximum medical optimization, there still may be a risk that you require a second procedure or revision procedure. Myth: FUE is better than FUT. I would say both techniques are equally effective and have been used to produce equal results in patients that are balding. It is how the surgeon performs this technique that is important. Now, FUT is superior in the sense that you will get an overall higher number of grafts from any donor. FUE would be superior in the sense that there is usually a shorter downtime. If you only do a FUE procedure, however, you would usually be able to get fewer number of grafts than if you do an FUT procedure. There are now described hybrid procedures where you do a FUT strip followed by a FUE harvest for the maximum number of grafts for each mega session or giga session. That's more than 3,000 to 4,000 grafts per session. Myth: hair transplantation is very painful. Now, this is, I would say, largely a myth, because done under the right hands, in the right conditions, hair transplantation procedure is done under local anesthetic, which should provide adequate surgical numbness to the areas that we are working on. And if you start to feel pain during a hair transplant procedure, you should inform the surgeon, because he will be able to calibrate the local anesthetic, like for example doing a top-up or doing a nerve block in order to achieve that surgical anesthesia. The days after the hair transplant usually don't require too much pain medication. There are exceptions to this, of course. If the skin is necrosed or the blood vessels supplying the area of skin is damaged, you could experience ischemic pain. That is an emergency that requires very intensive treatment. Sometimes some patients are more sensitive to pain than others and require a little bit more painkillers, analgesics, than patients who have a high tolerance. The risk of infections also increase in the days after a hair transplant, and infections can cause a different kind of pain, soreness or tenderness in areas that have got skin infections like cellulitis. Next myth, hair transplants can only restore hairs on my head. We know that it's not true. We can use hairs from the donor area in the scalp to restore, for example, scars to the beard. We can use it to correct the eyebrows, sideburns, various areas in your body can benefit from a hair transplant procedure. If you'd like to know more about eyebrow and facial hair transplants, please check out our videos in our YouTube channel. Myth: I can get immediate results from the hair transplant. Now that's entirely untrue. Hair transplants usually involve a period of shedding between week 3 up to month 4 before you start noticing scanty growth across the implanted areas between month 4 onwards to month 6. And after month 6 to month 9 is when the density really picks up. The final results of a hair transplant are not even at the 1 year mark. Though you see good results at the 1 year, there will still be some cycling of the hairs where the implanted hairs may have shed and trying to regrow a new strand even up to the 18th month mark. That's when we really see the most natural effects out of a hair transplant, so it's never an immediate result. So we've finished answering all the myths today. However, if you've had any unusual experiences after a hair transplant, or if you have unusual questions that you would like to ask us, please put them in the comments box below. Thank you, and we'll see you next time.